Come on, give God a hand cup of praise. Come on, give God a hand cup of praise. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, give God a hand cup of praise. If you are glad to be in the house of the Lord, come on and lift him up. Come on, come on, help me set the atmosphere. Set the atmosphere. Come on and set the atmosphere. If you are expecting, have a move of God. Come on and lift your hands all around the building. Come on and lift your hands all around the building. Come on and lift your hands all around the building. If you know that he's here, he's ready. Come on, he's ready to move. He's so ready to move. Come on, as the praise team come. Come on. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. You are here, moving in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. Moving in the mist, I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Our God, that is who you are. Lift your voice and say,
Waymaker,
miracle
worker,
promise. Come on, help me worship him.
Light in the darkness. Our God,
come on, we might as well worship him.
Are.
Oh, you. Come on.
Light in the darkness.
Our
God.
Come on.
That is
anybody come to worship him? If you know him as a way maker, way maker.
Way maker.
Miracle.
Miracle work.
Promise.
Promise keeper. Light in the darkness.
Our God.
My God. That is who you are.
Come on, lift your hands. Lift your voice and worship him right there. Come on, if you know him as a way maker, if you know him as a promise keeper, I dare you to lift your voice and say, God, I know you as a way maker. I know you as a promise keeper. I know you for myself. Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop. Lift your voice.
Even when I can't see it, you're working.
Even when
I can't feel it, you're working.
You never stop. Come on, anybody believe that? Oh, you never stop.
You never stop.
Come on.
You never stop.
Come on, stay right there. Oh, you never stop.
You never stop. You never stop.
Come on, you never stop.
You never stop. You never stop.
Never stop working.
You never stop. You never stop.
Never stop.
You never stop.
Come on, lift your voice. Oh, you never stop working.
You never stop. You never stop.
Oh, you never stop working.
You never stop. You never stop
working. Never stop
you
working.
Never stop. You never stop working. Whoa, whoa, whoa. You never stop. You never stop working.
Moving in our midst. We worship you. We worship. You are here. Hey! Turning lives around. We worship you. We worship you. You are here. Moving in our midst. Worship you. We worship you. Come on, lift your hands and worship him. Oh, Jesus. Come on, just for a few more moments, lift your hands. Come on, lift your hands if you need him. Come on, lift your hands if you need him. Come on, lift your hands if you need him. I know that there's so many things going on in the church world. There's a spiritual attack that has happened and has gone on in the apostolic church and in other churches. But I believe that God has rested. God has raised up a remnant church that's determined to praise his name, that's determined to preach the gospel, that's determined to live holy, that's determined to live righteous. Come on, lift your voice in this place. Lift your voice in worship. Let the Lord know that you're determined. You're determined to live right. You're determined to love right. You're determined to hope right. You're determined. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. Even when I can't see it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop.
Even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working.
You never
stop. You never stop working.
Never stop.
You never stop. You never stop working.
Even
when I can't see it, you're working.
Stop. Can anybody
never
testify to that?
Working.
Oh, you never stop.
You never stop.
Even when
I can't see it, you your word.
Even when
I can't feel it, your word.
Oh, you never stop.
Come on. Never stop.
Oh, you never stop. Come on, stay right there. Oh, you never stop.
Even when I can't see it, your word.
Even when
I can't feel it, your word.
Oh, you never stop.
You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working.
Oh. 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 I love for it. I love forever. Oh, I love forever. I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord. Lift your voice and say, I love you.
I love you.
Come on, anybody love him? I love you.
I love you forever.
I love you.
I love you. Woo! Forever, Lord.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you.
Come on, if you love
forever.
Him, help me say, I love you forever.
I love you forever.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you forever, Lord.
One more time, say,
forever.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you forever. I love you forever, Lord.
And we say glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Say glory.
Glory to God.
Glory to God
forever.
Come on, say glory.
Glory to God.
Look at your neighbor. Tell.
Glory to God.
Glory,
glory to God forever.
Come on, glory.
Glory to God.
We say God.
Glory.
All around the building, worship him. Come on, worship him for who he is. Worship him forever. We worship forever. We worship forever. We worship forever, Lord. We worship forever, we worship forever, we worship forever, Lord. Come on, worship him. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Sometimes words can't explain, and the only thing you got on your lips is, oh, Jesus. Oh, when you can't see your way, you can say, oh, Jesus. All the time you say, oh, Jesus. Come on, the enemy sometimes he can't understand when you say, oh, Jesus.
need you, God, to accept my own. Come by, Jesus, and grab my own. Lift your voice and say, oh, Jesus, out of my belly shall flow rivers, rivers of living water. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, oh. Nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like you, Lord. Oh, oh. Nobody like you, Lord. Nobody like the Lord. Nobody like the Lord. Lift your voice, say, oh, oh, oh. Nobody like you, Lord.
Nobody like
come on.
You, Lord.
Nobody.
Nobody like you, Lord.
Come on. Lift your voice, say,
oh, oh, oh.
Nobody like you, Lord.
Nobody come like on. You, Lord.
There's nobody like
nobody
the Lord.
Like
come on, give God a hand cup of praise. All of God's worshipers.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is there anybody, hallelujah, that was determined to come into the house of the Lord? Hallelujah. With a praise on their lip. Hallelujah. That wasn't waiting for the praise team. Hallelujah. To worship God for them. Hallelujah. If that's you, I want you just to begin to say, hallelujah. 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 He's been better than good to us. Hallelujah. We don't need, hallelujah, someone, hallelujah, to usher us into. We can go in all by ourselves. Hallelujah. Oh, because when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. My soul cries out, hallelujah. Hey, when I wake up in the morning, I want to give him thanks. Hey, before I go to bed, I want to give him thanks. Because if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? Hallelujah, hallelujah. So when I say praise the Lord, hey, hallelujah. We come too custom with praise the Lord being a greeting. Hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Praise the Lord means to do just that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. There's somebody somewhere in a wheelchair that wish that they could praise the Lord the way that you can. Hallelujah. If you got arms that can move, hallelujah, begin to lift them up and praise the Lord. If you got feet and you can walk, hallelujah, begin to leap for joy. Hallelujah. And thank God. that you might not always be able to do that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We welcome you to Circle of Hope Family Life Center. Hallelujah. Where we owe God a praise. We owe God a praise. And we thank him for being in the center of our circle. We're asking that you greet someone in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, oh. Jesus.
Come on, clap those hands.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy.
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 Joy in the morning.
I get joy.
Joy in the evening.
I get joy.
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 Everybody clap those hands. I get happy when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get happy when I think about
what he's done for me.
Do you get happy when you think about
what he's done for me?
You get happy when you think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy.
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 Anybody get joy?
I get joy.
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 Everybody clap those hands. Come on. Clap those hands.
Hey.
I get peace when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get peace when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get peace when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get peace when I think about
what he's done for me.
I get joy.
I get joy.
I get joy.
I get joy.
I get joy. Come on, clap those hands.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, circle of hope, praise the Lord, circle of hope. Do you get joy when you think about what the Lord has done for you? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Whew. Let's give a clap for all of our visitors in the building today. Hallelujah. We thank you for coming to fellowship with us on today. Hallelujah. Just a few announcements for this afternoon. We do have prayer call every Monday at 5:30 a.m. and Thursday at 10:30 p.m. So if you'd like to get plugged in and pray with us, please reach out to us. We'll give you the number to connect with us. Also on Tuesdays, our sisters, we do have our prayer call every Tuesday morning at 5:30 a.m. So if you'd like to connect, please reach out to Lady Valerie for the Zoom information and we'll get you connected. Also, our team, they have their prayer call every Wednesday at 8:30 p.m. So if you like your team to get connected, please reach out to Sister Kim Campbell. And our men, they have their Zoom prayer call every Wednesday at 8 o'clock p.m. as well. So if you like to get connected, please reach out to Elder Nehemiah. Also, we do connect every Tuesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study. So we do invite you all to come out and join us. And also, I'm pleased to announce that our men will have their first men's conference April 14th. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So if you like more information on that, please get with Elder Nehemiah. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. It's good for us to be here another Sunday. Y'all, these last couple Sundays have been phenomenal. Amen. We've had some rich word that has been going forth, and today is no different, y'all. And so I'm in great expectation. Somebody probably asking, well, Pastor, when are you going to preach again? Look, y'all, it's a whole lot to pastoring and preaching. You know, we're doing Bible study. We're doing this series, and it's been going good, y'all, this wisdom series. How many have been enjoying the wisdom series, y'all? And so we're in here teaching, and so make sure you're here in Bible study, right? But right now, these next 2 weeks, then, you know, I'll be back in here, all right? All right? And so, but it's been some good word, y'all. And so I appreciate what God is doing and how he is raising up ministry right before our eyes. And that's the beautiful thing about what's going on. You know, those that, who felt the call and accepted, answered the call to ministry and being groomed and mentored and being discipled. You know, discipled is the most important part of that, right? And so God is raising up some powerful preachers. Y'all, I am not the best preacher in the house, and I love it. I love it, right? I love it. I am not the best preacher. And so I'm grateful to God. You know, we all have our different grace areas. And so here's what we're going to do really quickly. We want to get this out the way now and give us an opportunity to partner in the offering, all right? And so we bless the Lord for those of you online. Let's clap our hands for them online. There are some people online that have never been to our church, and they sow, right? They sow and they give and they support the work of the ministry. They believe in what God is doing in this house, and so we bless the Lord for you. Some of you, I don't even know who you are, right? And so we're just grateful. Amen. We're grateful for our friends in Pakistan, y'all. Y'all think it's really real, y'all. We have friends in Pakistan who I kind of meet with every week, and they watch our services, and I had an opportunity last week to minister online to a whole crowd of people, believers in Pakistan. Yeah, we had translators and everything, and so. You know, they are very excited to hear the word of the Lord, and they want to be a part of Circle of Hope, and so we want to embrace them. We're probably going to get a Zoom or something with our babies and connect with their babies really soon, all right? So it's what it is, all right? But we're going to go ahead and stand. Let's support the work, partner in ministry today. Those online, you can see three ways to give. Actually, four. You can give via Cash App. That is $ Circle of Hope, FLC. Or via GiveLify, Venmo, right? And so that is Circle of Hope, FLC at gmail.com. And so, babies, you have your dollars. Where are the babies at? Babies, make some noise in here. Babies, y'all ain't making no noise. We're the young, we're everybody under 18. Where y'all at? Make some noise in here, all right? Make some noise in here. I know you ain't a baby if you're under 18. I mean, if you're at 17, 16, look, Sakai, like, I'm about to graduate. I ain't a baby. Y'all are our babies. We love you all. Let's go ahead and stand. And so as we prepare to give, we know most of us give online. And that's great. We're going to bless this offering and allow us an opportunity to give. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, God, for this offering. We thank you for the opportunity to sow. We're sowing cheerfully, God, because you love a cheerful giver. And God, we just honor you right now, oh God, for just giving us seed to even sow. And we pray, God, that you continue to be glorified in all of our lives, God. And may we trust and honor you in every way. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 All right. Here's what I want us to do really quickly. I just want us to stand one more time. Let's stand to our feet. Stand to our feet. And I want you to kind of connect with some people, two or three. If it's four, that's okay. I don't know if you understand what's going on in our world. We see the bad, we see the evil, we see the shootings, we see the violence, we see the confusion, the discord, the division. We see all of that, right? But do we really see what God is doing in spite of all of that, y'all? And that's what we want to see, all right? We want to look past, not look past it, but we don't want to be overly consumed by all of the negative press and things that we see on social media, but to actually see that there is a true awakening that is arising, all right? The Spirit of the living God is pouring out in a major way. And I know Sister Ariana, I heard she wanted to rotate and she wanted to get out to Kentucky, and so many people are going over there to the point where they had to shut down the whole city, right? They shut down the whole city because they're not letting any more people into Asbury, to that campus, into that city, because the whole city, the whole town is overwhelmed by the presence of the living God, all right? And so you can see what's happening, right? There's an expectation. There's a hunger that is arising in our nation. All right, everybody ain't going to hell. Everybody don't serve the devil, right? And so God is pouring out, and there's revival happening, all right? And there's different pockets of revival that is spreading throughout, amen, our nation. And so we may not be able to get to Asbury College today, right? So, you know, Lady Valerie's like, hey, after church, we want to go. We off on Monday. Let's go over there, right? Let's go. And she was serious, right? And I'm serious. We might as well, why not? But they closed off that city, but they can't close off the presence of the living God, all right? And so the same God, the same Spirit, the same presence that is in Asbury, that is bouncing to other campuses across the nation, amen, we believe even right now that same Spirit is here, hallelujah. And as you link up with your groups of three or four, amen, as Sister Campbell is going to make her way, hallelujah, amen, she's going to minister a word. And why I want to do this, because the word that she shared with me, I texted her this morning. I said, what's your theme? I'm gonna let her tell it. Amen. I said, what's your theme today? And she gave me the theme. I said, oh God. Oh, God, all right. So you ain't playing no games, and you coming out swinging. And so if the Holy Ghost is going to come out and he's trying to help us, we want to make sure that our hearts and our minds are ready to receive the word of the Lord. I told her breakthrough is in the house today. Amen. Deliverance is in the house today. Hallelujah. Joy is in the house. And before she even comes up, I want us to pray a prayer of expectation. But mostly what this prayer is, this is a prayer of repentance. You see what's happening in Asbury? They are over there crying out in repentance and true humility before the living God. And that's why the presence of God is resting on that place. And he's not leaving, and they're not leaving. And let me tell you something. If we're going to gather in the house of the Lord, we might as well get what we need, get what we came for. Hallelujah. So even right now, begin to open up your mouth. Let me tell you, in Asbury, they don't have a bunch of drums and a whole full orchestras and pianos and organs. They have a couple things here and there, but y'all, for the most part, they are lifting up their voices unto God. They are pouring out their hearts to the living God, and God is meeting them in that place. I want us right now to begin to open up your heart, open up your mouth to God, and just repent. God, I'm sorry. God, I'm sorry. Forgive me of my sin. Forgive me, hallelujah, of my unfaithfulness. God, forgive me of doubt. God, forgive me, hallelujah, for anything we're harboring in our hearts that's not like him. Forgive me, hallelujah, hallelujah, God, for being carnal-minded. Forgive me, God, in the name of Jesus, God, for not having a fire down in my soul. God, help me, God, for being overly consumed with the cares of this world. Come on, I need somebody to open your mouth this afternoon, amen, because the Spirit of the living God is here, and he's going to help us. He's going to speak to our hearts. He's going to give us the strength we need. He is going to save us, our families, our children, our children's children. Hallelujah. He's going to help. He's going to pull people out in our community. Amen. People are going to awaken to the true light. Amen. He is that true light. Hallelujah. That comes down from heaven. There is no light like him. He is the true light. He is the one that will illuminate our souls and lead us, hallelujah, down the path of righteousness for his name's sake. I need somebody right now to begin to open up your mouth, hallelujah, out of true sincerity of heart. Amen. Come on, right now, God, Father, in the name of Jesus, stir up a hunger in our souls, God. Blessed are they that do hunger and thirst for righteousness. God, you said we shall be filled. God, our heart's desire is to be filled this afternoon. God, we don't want to just come and go through the motions and have church and go home. God, we want to be changed. We want to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. God, we want to be quickened with the power of the Holy Ghost. God, Holy Ghost fire. Hallelujah. God, quicken us. Become alive in us. God, help us right now, God, to get a hold of a love, to get a hold, hallelujah, of a confidence in you. Hallelujah. To get a hold of the fear of the Lord, which will cause us to hate evil and to do justly and to love mercy. Help us in the name of Jesus, God. Hallelujah. To put away idol worship and idol gods and, hallelujah, little things here and there, God. Hallelujah, the little foxes that eat up the vine, God. Help us, God, to cut off those things that are hindering us from progressing forward in the name of Jesus. We pray right now, God, that your will be done. We pray right now that the power of the living God will rest in this place. Rest in this place. We're not just in this place, but rest in our hearts, God. Christ in us is the hope of glory. God, we need that yoke-destroying anointing of Jesus Christ, God. Hallelujah. God, to break up everything in our hearts, God, as we break up the fallow ground of our hearts with prayer and true repentance, God. You break up everything that's not like you, God, that we might be saved, that we might be holy, we might be set apart, we might be used for the glory of the living God. I need somebody to shout glory. Come on, shout glory and clap your hands in this place. Come on, shout glory and clap your hands. The word have not even went forth yet, but we're already clapping our hands because our expectation and hope, amen, is that this word is going to do and it's going to accomplish every purpose that he has sent it forth. His word is not going to return unto him void. I need you to clap your hands in expectation. It's not returning unto him void. Amen. We're going to get the deliverance. We're going to get the healing. We're going to get our miracle. Hallelujah. We're going to get that fire back. We're going to get what we need to get closer to God. Let's clap our hands. 30 seconds. Let's clap. Let's clap. Let's clap. Come on. We usually wait until the service is over and you clap. Amen. We're clapping right now. We're telling God, God, I'm in expectation. I'm in expectation. We want revival to break out. We want revival to break out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Where we forget about everything. Everything we got to do. Asbury, over a week long, they don't care about nothing. I don't care about word class. I don't care about games and basketball. I don't care about TV. All I want is you. All I want is Jesus. They're sitting. They're out in the line. They can't even get into the chapel where everybody is. They're laid out in the line going after God. What will happen? We get that kind of hunger for the living God. Let me tell you, every miracle you need will happen. Every breakthrough you need will happen. We get that kind of hunger and desperation for the living God. Hey, let me get out the way. Well, I wasn't in the way. That was the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to let the Holy Ghost continue to move and speak to our hearts. And the voice of our very own sister, Kimberly Campbell. Let's greet her with a hearty praise the Lord. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, God. Hallelujah. I thank God for who he is. I thank God for what he's done. I thank him for his spirit and his word. I thank God. This weekend, I felt sick in my body, and I've been taking medicine every few hours and sleeping, and, you know, but I wasn't going to stop that. I wasn't going to let that stop me from delivering the word of the Lord today. So I just praise God. I feel good today. I feel back to my normal self, and my throat is not as scratchy, and my head is not as cloudy. And I thank God for giving me the strength to push through that. And happy birthday to my middle child, Kobe. Happy birthday, Kobe. He's 5 today. So we praise God for him. He's our child that had to help us mature as parents. And so as he grows, we're growing. So we praise God for him. I praise God for my husband. Everybody give my husband a hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm so thankful for the Holy Ghost and the transformation power that I witness in him every day. And as we sleep and turn over on Sunday mornings, he gets up and he comes to serve in the house of the Lord. And he was sent home today, but he was ready to come and do his due diligence unto the Lord. So I praise God for him. And, you know, as it was a working week in the Lord for me, he was able to hold down the fort and keep our kids in our house together. Our house is not burned down. So I praise God for that. And so, you know, I can't say that I'm overly excited, but I'm excited about what the Lord has for you and what he's going to do in your hearts today. And I know I'm not going to get a whole lot of amens. I don't look for that, but as long as it's pleasing in the sight of the Lord and it does what it was intended to do. And although that we've prayed, it's on my heart to pray once more. So if you can make it personal to yourself, do that, whatever you have to do. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word, oh God. We thank you for your presence, oh God, that you so graciously have bestowed upon us today, oh God. Everything that we need is in our midst today, oh God. Joy, strength, love, breakthrough, oh God. Correction, oh God, everything that we need, you've provided us today, oh God. We ask, oh God, that you let the word fall on good ground, Lord God. Hallelujah, Jesus, let it cut off what it may, oh God. Correct where it may, strengthen and comfort where it may, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for always loving us, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus, even more than we loved ourselves, Lord God. We give you the praise right now in Jesus' name. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to be bouncing around a lot in the word today. The Lord deals with me just a little bit differently than most people, and so they call me a treacher instead of a preacher, because there's always something to teach or something that the Lord has instructed me to teach, and so I think that this is no different. But we're going to start in Romans 6, 1 through 14, and then we're going to move around. A lot of scriptures are going to be read into your hearing, and some I'm going to ask you to go there. If you normally take notes, this may be a good one to take notes. If you would like to stand, you can. If you would like to go to Romans 6, 1 and 14, you can. I'm going to be reading it into your hearing. So what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also shall walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye shall obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and as your members, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. And lastly, verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. And so I'm going to try not to be before you long, and I'm going to minister a little bit over the thing. We can have victory over sin. And so I'm going to try to stick with my notes as much as possible, but the Lord will do what he needs to do. Amen. And so as believers, our adversary is the devil, but our true opponent is sin. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy with temptations of sin. Without being granted the permission to tempt us with sin, Satan wouldn't even be a factor in our fight as saints. His only job is to get us to go against God, to separate us from God, and only sin does that. See, the temptation part isn't the sin. It's only when we give in to that temptation and allow our lust to be conceived do we bring forth the sin. So I want to go back for a second. In the Old Testament, there was no redemption for sin yet. There was only a covering. And so if you read the Old Testament and you dwell there a little bit like I happen to do, you'll see they do a lot of animal sacrifices. And they talk about the temple and how they bring animals to the altar. And once a year, the priest will go into the mercy seat and do an offering for the Lord. And there was no redemption for sin. So sin wasn't taken away. It was just covered. There was grace in those sacrifices. Right? And so although salvation was the plan from before the foundation of the world, so what we have now and how we can be baptized and for the remission of our sins and filled with the Holy Ghost, that's always been the plan since before the foundation of the world. But in the Old Testament, that plan wasn't revealed yet. It hadn't happened yet. And so since it didn't come to pass until well after the Old Testament time, there was only a covering for their sins back then, right? And so they could actually do a sin offering and then go, and maybe they wouldn't commit that sin for a week or a month or 2 weeks. But then there was no transforming in them, right? There was no regeneration. They didn't have anything to change who they truly were on the inside. And so they would come back again to have that sin covered once more. And so 1 Peter 1:18 through 20 says, for as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your father, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish or without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you. Because the wages of sin is death, right? Those wages had not been paid yet. And so the sin offerings, such as animals and bulls, they only put a band-aid over the true wicked heart conditions of the people. And so it only allowed for that act of sin to be covered, not for full remission of sin. Right? And so it wasn't until the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus that the power of sin had been broken off the people, that the power of sin had been broken off of us, right? And so when we get to the book of Romans, that book was written by Paul to the believers in Rome from all churches, not just one church. And in this book, he makes references specifically to Gentiles. And so in the Bible, we have to understand that the Jews were God's chosen people, and they felt like that they were better than everybody else. And so the Greek definition of Gentile is a foreign one or a non-Jewish person. So we would be considered Gentiles. We're not of Jewish descent. We're not Jewish people, right? So this was written, of course, after the first outpouring of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, right? And so the whole point of Romans was to remind the believers of the righteousness of God and the righteousness that was inherited by their new birth experiences. So Romans was kind of like a, okay, you've been baptized, you've been filled with the Holy Ghost, you're saved, but that's not it. Like, there are things you got to be careful of. There are things you got to pay attention to. There are things you kind of got to guard yourself from. You got to prepare yourself for these types of things that are going to come your way, right? There's some things that you have to understand if you're truly going to walk this thing out and make it on the other side, right? And so throughout the beginning of the book of Romans, he makes it clear. Paul makes it very clear that the need of salvation was sin, right? Then he moves into speaking about being justified, so being declared righteous by God through faith in Jesus Christ. And then he moves into the results of salvation. Now that we have it, what happens because we have believed and accepted the gift of salvation? And so he starts chapter 6 by asking a question. He says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?" So shall we continue to sin because we have been granted grace? So, of course, the right answer should be no. That's what we should be saying. But the issue for so many believers is not a solid no. We don't just say no, right? We might say, well, we can't do that sin, but is that really a sin? So it's not a solid no. Many of us take sin too lightly, right? And I talk to my youth all the time about salvation being tangible. That's for anybody. We feel like because salvation isn't something that I could just poke at or touch or grab or slide in my pocket when I need to pull out and use it, that we could just tread lightly. Right? We could tread lightly in our salvation. Well, if we don't do that sin, then we're good. If we forget about that one sin, then the rest should be covered, right? And so we see the undeserved grace of God as an excuse to continue in sin instead of using it as the intended purpose. So a lot of people see God's grace as something that's, oh, he'll just forgive me. The Bible says that if I confess my sins, he'll be just to forgive. They miss that word just part, right? He's going to forgive you because he wants us to forgive. And so it's just like we tell our kids, right? You can't tell your kids, don't hit, and then all they see you do is hit. You can't tell your kids, don't cuss, but when you're telling them not to cuss, you're cussing them out, right? And so it's like that parent. He wants us to forgive, and so he shows us much grace and mercy, right? And so we use as an excuse, oh, if we just sin and we ask for forgiveness, he'll forgive us, right? And so, but God's grace makes us free from sin. So we miss the intended purpose. His grace was never intended for us to continue in sin. His grace was intended so that we now see ourselves free from sin. We don't have to go back. We don't have to do that. I don't have to come and ask you to forgive me because I never have to touch it again. We don't use it the way that it was supposed to be used. And so his grace gives us permission to walk in righteousness. His grace gives us permission to walk in the newness of life, but we're still flesh. So sin is still going to attract us. There's nowhere in this word that says that I will save you and give you eternal life and you'll never have to be tempted again. There's nowhere that says that once you accept Jesus and you begin to walk righteous and you obey me and you follow my words and you listen to my voice and you harden not your heart and I hear you and you hear me, that you'll never have to go through anything. We're still flesh, right? We still have desires that come from our flesh. We still have places within our flesh that want to be fed with those things that we used to do. But the problem is that we give in to those things. Even saved, baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, we feel like that we can't say a hard no. When we're asked, should we continue in sin? The answer should be no. There's no gray with God. We say lukewarm, but there is no gray. It's either yes or no. It's either righteousness or unrighteousness. And the problem with the believers now is that there is no solid no. Right? We become impatient with the commitment that it takes to be what God has always intended for us to be. It's gonna be hard. It's gonna be difficult. It's gonna hurt. It's gonna ruin relationships. It's gonna cut off certain things. It's gonna bruise you in certain areas. But that's the commitment that we make when we say, yes, God, I accept you. Yes, God, I thank you for what you did on Calvary for me. Yes, God, allow your blood to wash me clean. Yes, God, I'll accept your gifts of the Holy Ghost. We lose that commitment when it becomes uncomfortable. We find more comfort in the things that he loosed us from than we do in the person who loosed us, right? And so we still fall into those things when our flesh gets weak and desires take time to disappear. We find comfort in those old things, right? And so God didn't die for you to go back to the old thing. The Bible says old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. He said, if we are in him, we are new creatures. He said, I made you new. I made you new. You don't have to turn back to the old things that you used to do. It's time for you to turn to the Father. And so we have to understand that in order to make it to glory, we got to know that because we have been buried with Christ through baptism and resurrected with him through the infilling of the Holy Ghost, we are now dead to sin and alive to God. Right? Verse 6 said, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, to cease, pass away, to be done with, no more. Why must we continuously pick up the things that we have done away with? Sin should no longer have dominion over us. I said before that during the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, that broke the power of sin off of us. Sin no longer has that power that we're giving it. Just like we hear all the time over the pulpit and Bible study and normal conversation, we give the devil too much credit. We give sin too much power. We give sin too much power. The power of sin has been broken off of us. We're no longer slaves to sin because our old selves was crucified. Sin can no longer tell us what to do. There should be no more reliance on those old comfortable things. We have to learn to fight against sin instead of yielding to it as if we are hopeless in the war. We're forfeiting in a battle we've already been granted victory over. You got to understand that once the wage was paid, the victory was won. You got the trophy, church. You got it. It's yours. All you got to do is show up to battle. All you got to do is show up to the battle. You've already got the victory. He's already paid the price. He's already won it. All you got to do is show up to the battle. Help, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. The Bible said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily beset us. Lay it aside. Stay away from it and allow the power of God to take away the desire to engage in that sin. Everybody has that sin that so easily beset us. But as I look around and I look from church to church and saint to saint, it seems like every sin easily beset us. Anything that's comfortable, anything that's more than comfortable than laying on your face and asking the Lord to help you. Almost every sin so easily beset us. It's like we're so fickle. We got the power of God on the inside of us and we're walking around broken. We're walking around leaning over like the leaves on our tree are too heavy. And it's not just physical sin. It's not just the ones you can see, the ones you can touch, the ones you can put down when the saints walk in. It's the ones in our heart, right? It's the jealousy, the envy, the discord, the divisiveness, right? It's the one where my opinion is better than yours because I said so. The pride, the greed, it's all those things. It's all those things. We get so caught up in the things that I can touch. Well, I don't smoke no more. I don't drink no more. I don't club no more. But your heart is just as nasty as it was when you started that stuff. We forget about those things. Help us, Lord. We forget about the things that can show up on a moment's notice because you forgot they were deep down in that place where you thought you hid it and you buried it, but it's not gone, it's still there. The moment he or she posts and it goes on your timeline, the moment he or she walks through the door, when you see that person that you just can't get over it with, it comes back. Help us, Lord. Mark 5, 17 through 23. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm sorry, that's the wrong scripture. We'll come back to that. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Y'all pray my strength. If you don't feel the glory of God, I do. Hallelujah. So we talk about the things that aren't always visible, right? And so the Bible says, for as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. It's not what goes into a man that defileth him. It's what comes out, right? You get that thought of what someone did or what they said in your mind, and you can't forgive them, or you can't let it go of this, or you can't let go of that, and that thought begins to settle in your heart, and all of a sudden, unforgiveness, bitterness, resentment, all those things start to consume your heart. And then, because the Bible also says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh, that word abundance means a surplus, right? So if I hate you until I can't hate you no more, there's going to be an overflow, a surplus over and above a normal amount in my heart. And in order for that to come out of your mouth, there's an overflow. There's an overflow. The Bible calls that sin. And then, if that's not bad enough, so it wasn't visible at first, but then you start sinning with your mouth, and then you start sinning with your actions. Now your sins are visible, and you can hear it, and they can hear it, and he can see it, and they can see it, right? But the Bible says, be angry and sin not. Awake to righteousness and sin not. My little children, these things I write unto you that you sin not. We've been called to holiness and righteousness. We've been called to walk as the children of light, to go and sin no more, to be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. We got to remember the cross. All of that was lost at the cross. We don't have to be entangled anymore because the cross, remember the cross, there was blood and water that leaked out, right? Blood for remission, water for regeneration. Remember the cross, there was blood and water that leaked out. Blood for atonement and water for purification. Remember the cross, there was blood and water. There was blood and water, but he, Jesus, not Sister Kim, not Brother Josh, not Pastor Derek, not Lady Miller, Jesus was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised, broken, crushed for our iniquities. He paid the price for us to be free from sin. Stop running back to the old master and put your hands up and ask the new one for help. We've already been granted the victory over sin when Jesus went to the cross. Now we gotta fight to keep it. Now we gotta fight to keep it. But how? How do we fight to keep it? How do we fight to keep it? It's easy to point out what we have to do, but now we're gonna talk about how we have to do that. How do we fight to keep it? Thank you, Jesus. We're going to go to 2 Corinthians 10 and 4. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We got to fight to keep it. We got to fight to keep it. 10 and 4, it says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Here's what you have to understand. Ephesians 4 and 12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Although sin may be visible sometimes, and we can see the act of committing sin in most cases, we aren't fighting the physicality of sin. We aren't fighting the physicality of sin. We aren't fighting the actual sin. We're fighting the stronghold in your mind that you believe somewhere along the line that what you're doing, you need it more than you need a God. So you thought sin was just about those things you do that God doesn't like and that you can't stop going back to them when you want to. That's not what you're fighting against. The sin is the thought of temptation that you've built a fortress stronghold around that has allowed you to believe that even though it's contrary to the will of God, I need it to survive here on earth. I need this to sustain where I am. I need this more than I need the Spirit of God. You've allowed yourself to be deceived. You've allowed yourself to be deceived. You can't fight that with a natural weapon. Although some of us may need a clinic, some of us may need a counselor, we can't fight some of the things that we've allowed to build up in our mind to keep us bound, even though we've been set free with a physical person. We got to fight it with the Spirit of the living God. We can't fight that with natural weapons. We need the Holy Ghost, the Word, and prayer and fasting to fight with. Hallelujah, Jesus. We're going to start with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. You know, while we're going to go to Galatians 5. And while we're turning there, just a small little testimony. I prayed this time. I said, Lord, I want to get a fluffy message this time. I want to get a hoot and shout, dance around the church message this time. He ain't listen. He said, no, that ain't what I got for you, sis. But I am willing and I am obedient. So Galatians 5, 16 through 17. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary, point blank, opposite. The one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things ye would. The Holy Ghost is one of our best weapons, right? We must walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh if we want to sustain in the war against sin. Remember, I told you the devil is our adversary. That is our enemy. But if you notice, there's only three things that he comes with: the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. They're all sin and temptation. He's plotting our downfall, presenting things that are not good for us in a way that we feel like are good for us. So our biggest opponent is sin. And so if we walk after the Spirit, we got to understand our spirit and our flesh will never agree. Our spirit and our flesh will never agree. Now, we can bring our flesh into subjection and make it agree, because we're going to do what the Spirit of God tells us to do. We're going to go where he leads us, but they'll never agree. We will always desire what we're not supposed to desire. We will always want what we're not supposed to want, because that's the flesh. That's the flesh. That's what makes a war a war. You got two opponents, two people that don't agree, two things that are contrary to one another. They'll never agree. So we have to be willing to yield completely to the Holy Ghost control. Completely, not a little bit, not in this or in that, completely, or we'll never be able to win the war against sin. Philippians 2 and 13 says, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do according to his good pleasure. Without the Spirit of God working in us, we wouldn't be able to stand against the temptation of sin. Because it is a constant choice. Right? It's a month by month, week by week, day by day, moment by moment choice to yield to the control of the Holy Ghost and not fulfill the lust of our flesh, right? We went to POW camp, and I don't know who was preaching, but they said, take this 60 seconds and use it and walk into the next 60 seconds. We are literally in a fight for our lives against sin, and if you got to, take it 60 seconds by 60 seconds, but don't yield to the desires of your flesh. We have to consistently follow the leadings and the promptings of the Holy Ghost and deny our flesh, which means if I have to follow the promptings and the leadings of the Holy Ghost and you still got time because the Lord is here, you got to possess the Holy Ghost. You got to have the Holy Ghost. 1 Thessalonians 5:19 says, quench not the spirit. The word quench means to extinguish or to put out. In order to walk after the spirit, we can't quench the spirit. We're never going to agree. We're always going to be contrary. Our flesh is always going to want to put out what the spirit of God is trying to bring forth. You got to be willing and obedient and say, okay, Lord, not my will, but thy will be done. If I want to step into that other side of glory and hear that well done, I got to go where you tell me to go. We have to know how to follow the Spirit when it leads us. And y'all, saints, church, we got to know when it's not the Holy Ghost leading us. We got to know when it's not the Holy Ghost leading us. Just like the spirit and the flesh are contrary. Light and darkness are contrary. They won't agree. They won't agree. So often the saints are led astray by what they think God said. If God said it, he ain't say it to you one time. If it was truly him, the spirit will agree when you open the word and it jumps out at it and said, daughter, son, I told you what I needed you to do. We want the wrong thing to be God so much that we just make it up. We make it up. We make it up. We want what he thought he should have said to be right so often that we'll make it up. Church, we will make it up. It's a whole book. 66 books, umpteen amount of words, so many instructions, directions, leadings, unctions, and the Spirit of God inside of you will agree with every single word of it. Church, we ain't got time to make it up. We don't have time to make it up. Either you're going to be righteous or unrighteous, but you better choose. We got to allow the Holy Ghost to help you be obedient to God's command. And I know you hear that word obedient and you want to run and you want to hide, but rebellion is sin. Rebellion is sin. If you go against any word on the page, any precept, any line, you've crossed over and you need to come on back. We got to be willing to be obedient and we got to let the Spirit of God help us. And this is not just for the people that I'm speaking to. This is also for myself. Please believe that I had to repent numerous of times this week. I had a rough week, but I praise God that I was able to take the correction. I was able to take the correction. Be obedient to God's command. Being obedient to the Spirit of God allows us to let go of control so that we can be righteous and holy. So that we can be righteous and holy. And this is Sister Kim speaking, not the Holy Ghost, but it grinds my gears when people say nobody's perfect. Jesus is, and he said we're just like him. So I'm striving to be perfect. I don't have time to fall into sin. The Holy Ghost has got to be one of our weapons of warfare against sin. Our second weapon is the Word of God. This is my favorite one to do. Whew, Jesus. the Bible, the sword, right? For Hebrews 4 and 12 says, for the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to divide asunder of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow. And it is we always leave this part out. It is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Everybody who's ever got on a pulpit that I've ever listened to left that part out. They left that part out. They'll pray for the word to cut. They'll pray for the word to strengthen. But when they read that part, they leave it out. It is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of our heart. We use the word of God is powerful and mighty, sharper than a two-edged sword when we're explaining it to somebody else. That two-edged sword got one on its end and one pointing back at you. Just like it can cut straight through their marrow, it cuts it off of your heart as well. And we forget that part. The word of God is designed to cut out and help us to remove the deepest sin of the heart. Y'all got to think, and I've said it over and over, but I'm going to do it again. So as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. This and this are connected, because if I think it here and I think it here long enough, it's going to travel to here. And if it gets here and it builds up long enough and it fills up and it overflow, it's going to come out of here or out of here or out of here or on my page or in my messages or in my phone call. It's going to come out. So before that comes out, we got to allow the word of God to cut it off. Cut it off. Cut it off. Be angry and sin not. Lord, I'm angry and I'm mad, but I need you to fix me. Cut it off, Jesus. Excuse me. The word of God is living and breathing. It's active with his spirit. You think he gonna put his spirit in us, but he don't put his spirit in his word? The spirit will agree. That's why when you're reading the wrong thing, that ain't it, Jesus. That ain't what I needed. I need to find you in here. I need to draw near to you in here. Draw near to me through my word. So the spirit may agree. We got to use this word to fight against sin. The word knows how to get to that deepest, most intense, most what you thought was secret, sin, right? We can't hide our sins from God and cut it right out. The word speaks to our heart and corrects the things contrary to it. We always say the word is a light unto my feet and a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. But if we think about a lamp practically, when you turn a lamp on, there's no more darkness. The darkness is gone. Light and darkness can't exist at the same time. So if I get the light in my heart, the darkness that was once there can no longer exist. So when we say it's a light unto my feet, you are lighting up the dark places in me. You are removing the things that are evil and that are wicked on the inside of me, because I'm replacing it with the light. When we put a light on our path and we're trying to see which way to go, the footsteps illuminate. We can see where to step. We can see where not to go. Oh, it's a frog right there. Oh, my footsteps go right here. Oh, I need to go back a little bit. I done went too far. I done strayed away. The word helps us to do that. If the word is in your heart, the wickedness has to go. That word have I hid in my heart so I may not sin against you. That's just not a cute children's church scripture that they can memorize so that they know one of them. That word have I truly hid in my heart. Where your heart is, so will your treasures be. Or where your treasures are, so will your heart be. Put the word in your heart. If you don't want to sin, get this word deep down in your heart. Hallelujah, Jesus. I read something while I was studying. And I like this kind of stuff because it helps me to really put it in context. It said, when it comes to the word, many believers are either anorexic or bulimic, right? Anorexic people don't eat enough. Bulimic people eat too much and then they just regurgitate. It just comes back up, right? We either take in just enough to keep us alive spiritually, never ingesting enough to be healthy or thriving, or we come to feed on the word often but never meditate on it long enough to get spiritual nourishment from it. It's not enough to just open the Bible or the app and read a verse every day. Whoever made up that lie, a verse a day keeps the devil away, is working on the other side. They're not working on the same side as you're working on. A verse a day keeps us in bondage and a slave to the enemy who knows the word better than you do. We got to read more than a verse. We got to know the word. We got to live the word. We got to ingest the word. We got to breathe the word. We got to be able to quote the word and the reason why it relates to what we just quoted it for. We can't just be just a walking Rolodex of scripture. The word teaches us to be in alignment with holiness. It's the most essential piece of armor that God gives us to fight with. 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Why would we not have to use the word? Even Jesus used the word to fight when he was tempted. Even Jesus used the word when he was tempted. I'm going to go to Matthew 4, and I'll read it in your hearing if you don't want to turn there. I got excited when I got to this point. I'm glad that you're excited. Amen. Matthew 4, verse 1 through 11. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. You know Jesus was bad. The Holy Ghost told him to go be tempted. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, and lest they shall bear thee up, lest any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And again the devil taketh him up into the exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he saith unto them, all things I will give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. We see here in Matthew 4 that every time Jesus came back with against the temptation, he said, for it is written, for it is written. Each time, for it is written, for it is written. But if you notice, the devil also said, for it is written. Jesus came back and said, but still, for it is written again, right? So that's why you got to know the word and have the word in your heart. Come on, church. You can't sharpen your sword the day of the battle. You can't sharpen your sword the day of the battle. You can't pull out your word the day that you're going through and feel like that it's going to walk you through. It can, because with God, we can do all things. But if we want to be realistic, you got to train. You got to know it. You got to believe it. You got to know what it said, because the devils know the word too. The devils know the word too. You got to be able to combat what you think is right. The word of God has got to be one of our weapons against sin. You can't come back when it is written if you don't know what was written. Hallelujah, Jesus. We've got to get this word so deep down that every time we open our mouth, it's a reference to God. Every time we open our mouth, it's a reference to a scripture. Every time we go to move, think, breathe, eat, sleep, jog, work out, there's a reference to God that falls out of us. You got to be ready to fight in season and out of season. He may not be attacking you today, but he might tomorrow. He may not tomorrow, but he might next week. It may not be about you. It may be about your children or your sister or your brother or your leaders or your boss. You got to be ready to fight. Hallelujah, Jesus. And our final weapon, prayer and fasting. I put these two together. It was tight what the Lord did when I put these two together like this. Well, when he put them together, because I didn't. I'm going to go to Mark 9 and 29. And he said unto them, this kind can come forth by nothing but prayer and fasting. So before I got this assignment and before the Lord took me on a crazy journey this time, I went all over the places. He led me everywhere. I guess there's some other things he was trying to teach me throughout this, but I would always say, and I don't know why, it had to be the Holy Ghost. Anytime I would reference something with somebody that they say was too hard to fight, I would say, well, this kind. And they'd be like, what you mean? I'd be like, well, this kind can come by nothing but prayer and fasting. This kind. I would always say this kind. And when we hear this scripture, we always relate it to a couple things. We relate it to the faith of the disciples, right? We related to Jesus teaching them some things, but I wanted to focus on the words this kind. So just a preview of the scripture, if you don't know, a man brought his son who was dealing with a dumb spirit, and he had been dealing with it since he was a child, and disciples couldn't get it to leave, and Jesus came over and said, I charge thee, come out of him, enter into him no more, and he left. So they were so confused as to why they couldn't do that, and he told them, this kind can come forth by nothing but prayer and fasting, and the Lord gave me a different revelation of this kind. So often we think about the prayer and the fasting part. We need to be praying. We need to be fasting. We need to look at this kind. Sometimes we have sins that are so deeply rooted in us. We have habits that are so vicious, that are so connected to us, that they become a this kind. Right? Unclean is unclean. It don't matter if it was a dumb, deaf, goofy, whatever type of spirit, unclean is unclean. But this kind, sometimes our sin are so connected, and we're so stuck by that stronghold that they become a this kind. That means you got to go at this kind a whole lot harder than you do the other ones, right? Some things when we get saved, the desire just falls off of us. Right? The taste just comes out of our mouth. But there's always just one or two things that we got to work at. There's always one or two things that's just so deeply rooted in us that I like to call that a this kind. You got to work hard, right? You got to put your prayer and your fasting together. You got to work. You got to pray over that thing. You got to call in some warriors with you. It becomes a this kind. Right? And so in the context of this scripture, he was speaking about that spirit that had been tormenting that boy since a child, right? And so this kind for us sometimes is our sin, our habits and our minds and our hearts that desire to be fed so much that we just do it sometimes without even thinking. They become ritualistic for us. They become habitual. We do it and don't even think about the fact of how many times we disobey God just by thinking about it, right? They become a this kind. These are the ones that we build the fortresses around, believing that we must continuing them in them, that we cannot let them go. These are the sins that grow in abundance in our hearts, this kind, right? And so when we think about prayer and fasting, the purpose of prayer is more than just a conversation with God. It's more than just talking to him. Some of us go and talk, and when we done talk, we be like, all right, catch you later. We don't even listen. We forget the conversation part. It becomes a monologue for some of us. That's not the purpose of prayer. This is where we enter into worship with God. This is where we're entering into submission, where we're submitting our will to his will, where we're getting in alignment with him. We're listening for instruction. This is where we get into his presence for ourselves. We ain't got the keyboard and we don't have the drums and we don't got the worship team up here pumping and priming for us to just worship him and praise him. This is where we get to know the sweet, sweet presence of God for ourselves. The purpose of prayer was never just to tell God something, right? This is where we get strength and strategy to fight. This is where we become transparent with God. This is where we lay it bare for him. Although he knows all things, we need to give it to him raw. In prayer, this is where we make that happen. Luke 18 and 1, men are always to pray and not faint. We should always be coming before God in prayer and not just to tell him all and leave. We treat God sometimes like Saturday Night Live. We just come up to talk and then we drop the mic. That's not the purpose of prayer, right? Jeremiah 29 and 12 says, then shall you call upon me, ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. We don't wait for that hearken part. We don't wait for that hearken part. We check the box on prayer. We miss the true meaning of prayer, right? Whereas fasting now deals with our self-control. Because in spiritual battles, there has to be spiritual control. We can't go into a spiritual battle controlling everything for ourselves. We gotta allow the Spirit of God to take over, right? And so the fight against sin is spiritual. When we fast, we are literally denying our flesh food. Besides all the evilness, our flesh truly desires to be nourished by food, right? And so basically, literally fast, putting your hand over your mouth and bringing your flesh into subjection to do exactly what the Spirit of God wants it to do, right? The Bible says that the flesh is weak to give over into desire. You want to make your flesh weak enough to get in subjection with God? Stop eating for a little while. Fill yourself up on word and prayer for a little while. Your body will be like, Lord, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. Where you want me to go say that to her right now, I'll go, God. When we fast, we are humbling and afflicting our souls. We're bringing ourselves down to a humble place where now the Lord can do what he needs to do. When we fast, we are empty and totally reliant on God to satisfy us and to fill us up. When we fast, we can hear from him more clearly. We can see more clearly. The word of God is more clear, and we can truly be led of him when we're fasting. And so you got to think, prayer, a time of worship. I'm aligning to your will. I'm getting strategy and instruction. I'm getting my fight plan. I'm getting things together. I'm truly coming into submission with your will. I'm moving my will out of the way. And fasting, I'm making no room for my flesh to have its own way. I'm making my flesh do the same thing that my spirit did in prayer by not eating. So when you bring these two things together, when you bring submission, worship, humbleness to meet with God's presence, God's voice, his instruction and strategy, oh, then you can speak to this kind. You can say, this kind I charge thee. Desire, come out of me in the name of Jesus. Enter into me no more. I have no more need of you. This kind, depart from my life. This kind, you are no longer needed. This kind, I will not go back to you. This kind, I'm free from you. This kind, I'm no longer your slave. When I bring those two together, I can say, Jesus, I give you all of me, and then you gotta go. With prayer and fasting, we just one up sin. With prayer and fasting, there is no battle. You can look at your trophy that the Lord has already won on your behalf. And you can speak to this kind and say, no longer will I serve two masters. No longer will I choose you. This kind. No longer are you such strong hold on me that I can't tell you no. This kind. No longer will you ruin my life. This kind. We got to choose to fight against sin, and prayer and fasting together has to be one of our weapons, but it still comes down to choice. It still comes down to choice. And I'm almost done, so if everybody can stand to your feet, the altar is open if you need to come up, but it still comes down to choice. And in today's world, we hear choice about everything. You got the choice of what you want to wear, where you want to go, what you want to eat, who you want to be, what you want to be, how old you want to be, what you want your name to be, what your hair should look like, what you smell like. We have choices for everything. And everybody knows the right choice to pick until we get to this moment. Until we have the choice to say, should we continue in sin? And we got the choice to say no, and we don't. Your salvation, redemption, freedom from sin was bought with the blood of Jesus Christ, and yet he still gives you the choice. He don't twist our arm. He doesn't force us to be saved. Although we are indebted to him, he doesn't force us to be clean. He doesn't force us to be free. He doesn't make us carry out his purpose. He gives us a choice. Even though we owe him, he gives us a choice. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. He still gives us a choice. Church, we don't have time to make the wrong choice. We don't know the day or the hour, but like Pastor Derek said earlier, God is pouring out his spirit upon us. The prophecy of the last days, they're coming to fruition. They're happening all over us. We see the corruption. We see the evilness. We are in the day where right is wrong and wrong is right. We're already past that day. We've already made it to that point. But you still have a choice. What will you choose? Will you choose righteousness over unrighteousness? Holy over unholy, godly over ungodly, victory over defeat. Will you choose to use the weapons he's freely given us to be victorious over sin? Or will you run back to the things that made you comfortable? If we want to be victorious, as Lady Valerie ministered last week and Sister Mary the week before, we have to get rid of sin's in our life? The answer to that first question that Paul asked, shall we continue in sin because grace may abound? We got to stand on a hard no, y'all. We got to stand on a hard no. Everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But if we're going to be a victorious people, a victorious church, have victorious households, we must have no place for sin in our lives. We got to remember the cross. The whole point of the cross was to redeem us back to blameless. The whole point of the blood was to cover our past sins. And the whole point of the water was to renew us so we can sin no more. We got to remember the cross. We got to remember the cross. No need to revisit who you once were. The price has already been paid. Why constantly make the choice to pay for something that you're getting for free? He's already paid for you. Your admission pass has been stamped. No need to go back. He didn't call us to be righteous sometimes. He didn't call you to be righteous and holy when it behooves you to do so. He said, sanctify yourselves and be holy, be separate, be set apart. We got to understand, he said, you're mine anyway. I created you. I never made you to be like them. I never made you to be common. You've always been a peculiar people. You've always been destined for a purpose. You've always been created to worship me in spirit and in truth. You were never created to be in bondage. And to prove that to you, I lay down my life. So why go back? He said, you were created in my image, in my likeness. You were created to be like me. You were created to hold the title that I gave you. You were created to run the race that I set before you. Why are you going back? Why are you going back? I never intended for this to be easy for you. I never intended for you not to be tempted, but I've already saved you from that. Why would you pick it back up? I've already taken the taste out of your mouth. Why would you remind yourself? I've already given you a renewed mind around that. Why would you keep thinking about it? I've already saved your family from that. Why would you put them in that situation again? Why would you go back? Why would you go back? He didn't wrap himself in flesh for you to play with it. He said he would rather you be hot or cold. He said, I'd rather you be hot or cold. You're going to follow, you're going to reject. You're going to be holy, you're going to be unholy. But whatever you choose, choose ye this day. You can't serve two people. Make your callings and elections sure. I'm coming back for a church without a spot, a blemish, or a wrinkle. Or you're going to be on the boat. Or you're going to be on the boat. We say same God all the time. Same God. Same God, same God that rose Jesus from the grave. Same spirit that saved this person. Same spirit that saved that person. Stop playing with God. He's also the same spirit that sent a flood to wipe out a whole nation for disobedience. He's also the same God that took Uzzah up just for trying to correct the Ark of the Covenant. He's also the same God that tore down Sodom and Gomorrah and didn't leave nobody standing but Lot. He didn't die for you to play with it. He didn't come so that we would be condemned. He came that so that we would be saved. And if you're baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost, you got everything you need to walk in the victory that was already set before you. You got to think, we turn the page from Old Testament to New Testament. That was 400 years where they didn't even hear from God, didn't see him. He didn't move. He didn't talk. He didn't whisper. He didn't speak. Sin was rampant. And even in the midst of that, he still allowed his plan to come to fruition, as the scripture says, for us, for me and my children and their children and their children. How dare you go back? How dare you go back? You're new. Be new. New habits, new desires, new obedience, new walk, new way, new vision, new mind, new heart, new members. Don't go back. Don't go back. I forget those things which are behind me, looking only to those things that are before me, and I'm pressing toward the mark of the high calling in Jesus Christ. We gotta press, church. We gotta press. No longer can we be beset by sin. Let it go. Let it go. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Oh, God. And if the Lord is dealing with your heart, hallelujah. He says, if your heart condemns you, that's not my purpose. That's not my purpose. I'm greater than your heart. I'm greater than your heart. I'm greater than your heart. If you haven't been filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost or gone down in Jesus' name to wash your sins away, he said, I'm greater than your heart. Once you become in me, there's no condemnation for them who are in Christ Jesus. Step into me for the one time. He says, step into me for the one time and you'll be glad that you did. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Don't go back. He said, don't go back. If you need somebody to pray with you, hallelujah, Jesus. There are plenty of people to play with you if you want to go down in the matchless name of Jesus. We got water. If you want to be washed white as snow, you ain't even got to go get no. We'll make sure we got something to change you into. No need to wait. It's too close, church. He's too close, church. It's happening too soon, church. He's on the way, church. We cannot be beset by the sin that we've already been delivered from. Hallelujah. Raise your hands in the name of Jesus. Father God, we thank you, oh God. We thank you for your spirit, oh God. We thank you, oh God, for the word that's gone forth, Lord God. We thank you, oh God, for the correction, the instruction, and the strategy, Lord God. You are able, and we thank you, oh God, for the price that you've paid on our behalf, oh God. Help us to walk in the victory, oh God, that you placed before us, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus, oh God, even as we depart from this place, oh God, let your word never depart from our hearts, oh God. We'll be sure to praise you and magnify you, oh God, because you're worthy in Jesus' name. Amen.
if you're doing anything right now but seeking the face of God, you missed it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're doing anything but seeking the face of God, you missed it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Correction is not to hurt your feelings, but it's to bring you closer. Hallelujah. If your mind is anywhere but in this house, you missed it. But you still have time because we're still here. Hey, caramosha. Kirosia nanamosa. Oh, God, I rebuke every rebellious spirit in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hey, Aramosha. When God is in the room, you must bow. And if you can't bow, you're in the wrong place. Hushi Aramosa. Kiaralalabosha. If you can't bow, you're in the wrong place. Hey. But he sent a word from the Lord to help you. Ushamaya Sirosa. Kiralabosha. He's trying to help you. Hey, Hiramosaya. He's trying to help you. Some of us miss that warning comes before destruction. Hey. Whoa. 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 Jesus. Yeah, there's still some that's missing it. There's still some that's missing it, but there's some that are saying, God, I'm here, God. Oh, God, I received the correction, God. Hallelujah. And this time I'm going to make that choice. Hayabosha. Hey, Aralabosia. Naki Aralabosha. Woo, Sayaramoshaya. Hallelujah. What will your response be? There's only two. You accept or you reject. There's only two responses. You accept the word of God and you say, God, if you be God. Or you reject. Whoosh! Oh. Come on. Come on. down and accept. Accept. Kiarabosha. Woo. Yay. Praise the Lord, as always. Those are that seeking can continue to seek the face of God. But those that need to dismiss, we understand. There are cupcakes in the back to celebrate our little brother Kobe that is sleeping nicely in the presence of the Lord. Amen. But again, if you need to go, we understand you've been dismissed. Amen.